If we line up the natural numbers and take the square root of each number, something fascinating happens. The square roots of all prime numbers become irrational numbers. For example, square root of 2, square root of 3, square root of 5, square root of 7, and this pattern continues indefinitely. What about non-prime numbers? They either produce an integer, like square root of 4 equals 2, or can be expressed as a coefficient times a radical, like square root of 12 equals 2 times square root of 3. Therefore, the irrational numbers obtained from square roots of primes serve as fundamental building blocks, much like the integers themselves. The first irrational number discovered by humanity was square root of 2, found by the ancient Greek mathematician Hippasus. Sadly, the Pythagorean school revered integers as sacred and considered Hippasus a traitor for discovering irrational numbers. According to legend, they drowned him in the Aegean Sea. Let's look deeper at these irrational square roots. All of them can be expressed as roots of polynomial equations. In fact, when we say square root, the word root refers to the root of a polynomial equation. Square root of 2 is the root of x squared minus 2 equals 0. Square root of 5 is the root of x squared minus 5 equals 0. Cube root of 7 is the root of x cubed minus 7 equals 0. Now, let's write the most general polynomial equation. It has the form a sub n times x to the power n plus a sub n minus 1 times x to the power n minus 1, and so on, all the way down to a sub 1 times x plus a sub 0 equals 0. Here, all the coefficients a sub I are integers. The roots of such equations can represent integers, rational numbers, irrational square roots, and all combinations thereof. Here's the profound question. Do the roots of all possible polynomial equations constitute the entire real number line? Let's give these numbers a name, algebraic numbers. These are numbers that are roots of polynomial equations with integer coefficients. The question becomes, are there real numbers that are not algebraic numbers? The concepts of algebraic numbers and transcendental numbers were introduced by the legendary mathematician Leonhard Euler. Yes, him again, Euler is everywhere in mathematics. Here are the definitions. An algebraic number is a number that can be a root of a polynomial equation with integer coefficients. And a transcendental number? That is, of course, a number that is not a root of any polynomial equation with integer coefficients. Here's the challenge. Algebraic numbers are roots of equations, so we can calculate them directly. For instance, solving x squared minus 3 equals 0 gives us square root of 3. But transcendental numbers, numbers that aren't roots of any polynomial equation, how do we even find them? We can't just solve an equation. Since they can't be calculated this way, how do we know they exist? Euler said, "We rely on intuition." Well, that's not very rigorous. After Euler proposed the concept of transcendental numbers in 1744, for an entire century, no one could rigorously prove they exist. Mathematicians strongly suspected that pi and e were transcendental, but no proof existed. Proving the existence of transcendental numbers became one of the great challenges of 19th century mathematics. Finally, in 1844, French mathematician Joseph Liouville stood up and declared, "I will prove they exist." Liouville's brilliant insight was this: if transcendental numbers don't exist, then algebraic numbers must be able to approximate each other arbitrarily closely with rational numbers. But what if algebraic numbers have a fundamental limitation? They can't be approximated too well by rational numbers. If we can show this limitation exists, then any number that can be approximated too well must be transcendental. Let alpha be an algebraic number of degree n. This means it's a root of an nth degree polynomial. Let beta equal p over q, a rational number close to alpha, where p and q are integers, with q greater than 0. Our goal? Prove that the absolute value of alpha minus p over q has a lower bound that depends on q. Since alpha is algebraic of degree n, it satisfies a polynomial equation. This equation has the form a sub n times x to the power n plus a sub n minus 1 times x to the power n minus 1, continuing down to a sub 0, equals 0. Here, f of alpha equals 0, and all the coefficients a sub I are integers, with a sub n not equal to 0. Since f of x has integer coefficients, when we evaluate f at p over q, we get a sub n times the quantity p over q to the power n, plus the next terms, all the way down to a sub 0. Now, multiplying both sides by q to the power n gives us a sub n times p to the power n plus a sub n minus 1 times p to the power n minus 1 times q, continuing with additional terms all the way to a sub 0 times q to the power n. The right side is a non-zero integer since p over q is not equal to alpha. This is crucial. Since q to the power n times f of p over q is a non-zero integer, we know that the absolute value of q to the power n times f of p over q must be greater than or equal to 1. This means the absolute value of f of p over q is greater than or equal to 1 over q to the power n. Now we apply the mean value theorem. According to this theorem, there exists some point c between alpha and p over q such that the following holds. F of p over q minus f of alpha equals f prime of c times the quantity p over q minus alpha. Since f of alpha equals 0, we can simplify this to f of p over q equals f prime of c times the quantity p over q minus alpha. For c near alpha, the derivative f prime of c is bounded. Specifically, the absolute value of f prime of c is less than or equal to some constant m, where m is greater than 0. Now we combine everything. The absolute value of p over q minus alpha equals the absolute value of f of p over q divided by the absolute value of f prime of c. This gives us the absolute value of p over q minus alpha is greater than or equal to 1 divided by m times q to the power n. And here it is, Liouville's inequality. The absolute value of alpha minus p over q is greater than or equal to c over q to the power n, where c is a constant depending on alpha. So what does this inequality tell us? Any algebraic number of degree n cannot be approximated too well by rational numbers. Specifically, if you try to approximate it with p over q, the error is bounded below by roughly 1 over q to the power n. There's always a gap. Now comes Liouville's genius move. He constructed a number that violates this inequality. This number is called Liouville's constant. L equals 0.11001, and so on. The ones appear at positions 1 factorial, 2 factorial, 3 factorial, 4 factorial, and continuing. Here's the key difference. Algebraic numbers cannot be approximated too well. They must satisfy the inequality. Absolute value of alpha minus p over q is greater than or equal to c over q to the power n. But Liouville's number can be approximated extremely well. It violates this inequality completely. Therefore, L must be transcendental. This was the first explicit example of a transcendental number in mathematical history. After Liouville's breakthrough in 1844, mathematicians built on his methods. In 1873, Charles Hermite proved that E is transcendental. In 1882, Ferdinand von Lindemann proved that pi is transcendental. Joseph Liouville was a modest yet brilliant mathematician. He was also the first to recognize the genius of Évariste Galois and popularized Galois' theory throughout the mathematical community. Liouville's proof of transcendental numbers was directly inspired by Galois' theory, leading to this elegant and groundbreaking result. We can visualize the hierarchy of numbers like this. The innermost circle contains the rational numbers. The middle ring contains all algebraic numbers, including the rationals. And the outer region? That contains the transcendental numbers, numbers that transcend algebra and escape the reach of polynomial equations. From Hippasus' discovery of square root of 2 in ancient Greece, to Euler introducing the concept in 1744, to Liouville proving their existence in 1844, and finally to the proofs that e and pi are transcendental in the 1870s and 80s. Mathematics continues to reveal the infinite richness hidden within the real numbers. This is the story of how transcendental numbers were proven to exist. Numbers that transcend algebra, that escape the reach of polynomial equations, that open up entire new realms of mathematical understanding. Thank you for watching.